Αν μπορούμε να αρχίσουμε, μήπως υπάρξει κάποια καθυστέρηση. Λοιπόν, θα μιλήσω όπως χθες στα αγγλικά, μήπως μας παρακολουθούν και κάποιοι που δεν μιλάνε ελληνικά. Good morning to all participants. All speakers are online, so we can start our second session, which includes four projects developed in the Institute of Historical Research concerning primary sources. It's exactly the second session on primary sources. We are going to listen all four papers and the discussion will follow at the end of the session. I would like to remind you that you can pose written questions on the by clicking the Q&A button at the bottom of the of your screen, or raise the hand and speak. Now, we have a small change in the program of the session. Dr. Nikos Livanos will start, and the next three speakers will follow as in the program. Dr. Nikos Livanos is a research collaborator in our institute. His research field is the history of Mount Athos and Orthodox monasticism, as well as Byzantine science from the 10th to 17th century. Today, he is going to speak about Mount Athos in the digital era, the Athos digital heritage as a reference point for the digitization and documentation of archival documents. Nikos.
Hello, good morning. Thank you very much. And sorry for this change in slight change in the program. I will just share my screen. Well, the holy community of Mount Athos, together with 12 monasteries of the Holy Mount, with funds from the operational program Competitiveness, Entrepreneurship, and Innovation of the 2014-2020 Partnership and Cooperation Agreement, implemented from 2016 to 2019 an innovative project titled Athos Digital Heritage, with a budget of approximately 9,400,000 euros. The main aim of the project was to present digital reproductions of the most important artifacts on Mount Athos, among other. Under the scientific guidance of the Research Director Emeritus of the Institute of Historical Research, the National Hellenic Research Foundation, Kriton Chrysochoidis, a total of 2,200,000 digital images were produced from all categories that include archival documents, manuscripts, old printed books, maps, icons and frescoes, metalwork, embroidery, coins, folklore items, as well as ceramics and sculpture works. These images underwent documentation by teams of specialists in each type of object. The number of objects that were photographed or scanned, the volume of data collected, and the volume of metadata produced makes this project one of the largest such projects in Greece ever. In particular, more than 140,000 documents and 20,100 archival codices were digitized, amounting to nearly 557,000 digital images. Meanwhile, 3,300 manuscripts, 1,512 old printed books, and hundreds of icons and artifacts all together produced more than 1,400,000 digital images. Now, access to this work is given through a portal with advanced search capabilities, also granting access to a high percentage of the full digital images. Not all of them, of course. In order to carry out the digitization, the monasteries were equipped with some of the best book and flat scanners available in the market, with a simultaneous upgrade of the communication infrastructure of Athos. So in this paper, I will talk about the problems we faced during planning, digitizing, and documenting the archival documents and codices, which was also the largest part of the project, and just how we managed to tackle a few of these issues, acquiring valuable experience for similar future projects for us historians. The task of digitizing and documenting the documents was implemented in three major phases. First, planning the project. Second, preparing the material for digitization. And third, the digitization and documentation, which took place almost simultaneously. Many of the challenges faced were owed not only to the volume of the material that we had to deal with, but also the particular conditions on Mount Athos, challenges that a smaller project with a smaller budget may not have been able to meet. During planning, the greatest challenge was to use a unified identifier number for all the documents in all the monasteries. And when I talk about monasteries, I include the Holy Community of Mount Athos, the Protaton as we know it, the governing body of Mount Athos, which is not exactly a monastery. This is not as easy as it sounds for two reasons. First, because most of the archives have not undergone conclusive classification, particularly the 19th and 20th century archives, and are not in a position to receive final taxonomic identifiers. And secondly, because even when these modern archives are taxonomically classified, each monastic foundation has followed its own proper way. Concerning the Byzantine era documents, the vast majority are today published, and therefore their taxonomic identifier equals their number in the edition for practical, but mostly for research purposes. The post-Byzantine era documents of Mount Athos, which covers the period from the 15th century up to customarily, although, well, kind of abusively, the year 1800, despite being found in much larger numbers, are still measurable figures. A great many of the Greek documents have been published in the form of regest after 1985 in the series Athonica Simicta of the Institute of Historical Research, while most Romanian and some Turkish documents have also been published in regest in various publications. The main difficulties concern the documents dated to the 19th century and the 20th century, which in any monastery can reach numbers as big as 100,000, while the large leading monasteries can boast numbers way above that figure. The taxonomical condition of these parts of the archives is often complex. In certain cases, they may have undergone two or more taxonomy efforts, depending on the needs or the perceptions of the monastery's archivists at times. As a result, in many cases, the initial archival units have been dismantled into units that served particular or trivial purposes during the late 19th or 20th century. In other cases, a certain part of the archive was classified because of an abandoned classification effort, or an effort to classify only the units that were useful to the monastery at a particular time. The pre-existing taxonomic numbers, wherever to be found, are different from one monastery to another, and Mount Athos does not have a unified taxonomical method. Each archive is definitely local for each monastery, and no third party is ever involved. To these issues, we must also add the riddling case during which a particular part of a modern archive has a totally different type of taxonomic identifier than another part of the archive as a result of various older digitization projects that imposed their own taxonomic principles on the archive. In order to tackle these issues and to be able to use a unified taxonomic reference method for all the documents of the project, whether they already had or did not have a previous identifier, we had to implement a solution which would exclude the location of the natural objects, meaning in which folder the document is placed, and which would allow for any future taxonomical arrangement of the documents of each monastery separately. So as a result, each document, and I mean natural object, not digital file, received the number in serial form, which was unique within each object category. The category was indicated by an additional number separated by a hyphen within the DOI. This produced the same identifier for both the natural object and the digital file. The number was written on each and every of the 160,000 documents using a soft pencil before the digitization so that it could be recorded as part of the document within the digital image to ensure that its ID is not lost if the file name is corrupt or any mistake is made during scanning. This process demanded numerous visits to Mount Athos by the project's team, and was assisted by the fathers of each monastery. This unified serial identifier, used mainly in identifying digital images, creates a bond between natural object and digital image, a bond which also includes their relationship with the metadata in the repository. Any pre-existing or future identifiers based on the folder of the original document is added in the metadata and can be retrieved from the database. This method allows not only the project to be implemented without waiting for a classification of each monastery's archive, which could take years or even decades, but also allows the monastery to experiment with future taxonomy without losing access to their documents' whereabouts. The next phase of the project was that of a digitization and documentation of the documents, which, although a totally separate procedure, took place in parallel. The digitization, mainly scanning of the documents, except for the very large ones that were photographed, took place at each monastery, which was equipped with state-of-the-art equipment that included flat scanners, book scanners, digital photo cameras with filters, and optical fiber cables connecting the monastery to the project's headquarters in Carrières, where the digital images were gathered in a highly protected server to be accessed by the documentation team working from various cities in Greece and certain cases around the world. Concerning documentation, experience with funded projects so far has shown that usually the characteristics of the technological tools developed within a project conventionally covered the funding of the project and its implementation timeframe. In the case of Athos Digital Heritage, our intentions were to create a platform connected to the repository that would have the entire set of specifics needed for a full diplomatic and historical documentation of the documents, covering all the particularities of Athenite documents. Therefore, the platform developed using the latest DSpace environment is tailored to work locally, to serve the needs of each monastery, and interconnected with other repositories as well. In order to achieve the documentation of all the documents within the short time frame of the project, the metadata inserted was confined only to the basic description of the document, the basic diplomatic description, and a short description of content. However, the monasteries now have the technological tool necessary to fully advance the levels of documentation, should they wish to do so. The largest, perhaps, challenge met during the design phase of the documentation platform was the ability for the documenter to open an unlimited number of metadata files from one parent file. The development of this feature was necessary for describing documents that are what we call collective copies, meaning a document that contains two or more copies of different documents, which are usually the case with archival codices. The general construction of documentation environments so far was based on having one metadata file equivalent to one digital image file, in the sense that the particular metadata file can carry all the necessary information that can be extracted from this particular image file. This, however, runs counter to the methodology of the historical description of a document, according to which the copy of one document, even if found among other copies, is still considered as a separate document, and that the parent document that contains all the copies is, from a diplomatic standpoint, a unique document with its own description. So the solution offered until then by existing know-how was to create separate image files for every document during scanning. But this was unacceptable because the person behind the scanner does not have the necessary knowledge to read the text and determine where one document ends and where the other begins. The next solution proposed, to have the image files cut by the historians, was also not an option, simply because there was no time for that, and because the metadata and the image file would be cut off from the entire document and the rest of the copies in the same collective copy document. And furthermore, since the material attributes of the collective copy were the same for each copy text, the material description would have to be shared. In the end, hard and pressing programming work managed to get the best out of the DSpace repository platform, and making child metadata files from one parent file by the documenter keeping a certain part of the metadata same was eventually made possible. Now, this technology was needed for some 20,100 archival codices and many loose documents, and it was one of the methodological breakthrough points of the project. In many ways, the project Athos Digital Heritage offered immense experience to all those involved, and particularly those involved in planning and implementing large digitization projects from head to toe. Among various challenges that the project had to overcome concerning archival documents were the special characteristics of the archives of the monasteries of Mount Athos, for which new software research was needed. To this, we should add the need for in-depth knowledge of the material by the documentation team, which created the need for the training of the more than 30 documenters involved only for the archival documents and more than 100 for the entire project. Continuous training, in particular, proved to be a key success, together with maintaining a group spirit among documenters, despite each person working from their own personal space. And thanks to cost-efficient workspace software like Slack, Microsoft Teams, or Google Chat, the members of the documenting team are invited to discuss issues and exchange experience on particular problems or historical content during the day. And finally, experience from this project shows that the large quantity of metadata produced is an absolute need for a two-phase quality control system that reduces the error margin to the lowest possible percentage. And the first phase is by the documenters themselves, and the second by a third party. Now, having said all this, a few thoughts. During project planning, an important success factor is, on the one hand, carefully setting the goals and implementation methods, and on the other hand, achieving quality collaboration between software developers and historians, whose job is to convey their vision of the end product in a way that is simple and understandable. And although this seems logical enough, it is not always the case. Beyond the many communication hurdles between both sides, historians often ignore the potential as well as the limits that current technology and the available know-how that the market has to offer. So as a result, easier technical solutions are usually chosen that do not need much time to develop, but do not always meet the way that historians envisage the assessment or presentation of their work. Now, to my humble opinion, and based on experience of the last 15 years working on such project, there is rarely, although I should say practically never, a constant flowing relationship between humanities researchers and software developers that could be focused on researching new methods of historical data assessment. The existing relationship is almost always confined to the limits of a funded project that has a strict time frame and acutely binding requirements. The development of a closer and stable relationship between humanities researchers and software developers at an institutional level, preferably with the assistance of digital humanities experts, would allow for the construction of a permanent bridge between the two fields, and for the ability to maturely plan technical solutions that can be implemented when funding is available. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Nico. And now, our second speaker, Dr. Evangelini Marcu. Evangelini is a senior researcher in our Institute of Historical Research, and she is an expert on the numismatic of archaic and classical Cyprus. Today, she is going to speak about Kyprios Charakter, concept and update of a website on the history, archaeology, and numismatics of ancient Cyprus. Evangelini, please.
Thank you very much. I hope that you are listening to me correctly.
Yes.
I am very happy to be part of this morning's session regarding the primary sources. And I will be presenting to you today the Kypriot Character website, which is a bilingual website that has been created in 2015 with funding by the Action Aristia 2. The research project that was included in that action was regarding the silver coinage of the kings of Cyprus, numismatics and history in the archaic and classical periods from the 6th to the 4th century BC. And this project started as an idea aiming to collect and study the silver coinage issued by various Cypriot kings in various kingdoms throughout the archaic and classical periods. In order to proceed, the project proposal had to be organized in work packages that would include various steps pertaining to the collection of the numismatic material kept in museums and private collections all over the world, the development of a numismatic database that would be enriched with the relevant numismatic material, the study and dissemination of the research results through scientific publication, as well as the development of the website. The website should be dedicated not only to numismatics, but also to various aspects of history and archaeology of Cyprus and the Eastern Mediterranean in antiquity in general. All of the above was realized in a 21-month span that involved the collaboration of experienced numismatists, archaeologists, and technicians that contributed greatly to the realization of the project, as well as under and postgraduate students who did their practice in our institute, in the Institute of Historical Research, by working on the website during and mostly after this first funding. My desire as a researcher living in a digitally evolving world was to create a scientific website that would become a useful tool for researchers, archaeologists, historians, epigraphists, students, coin enthusiasts, as well as the general public. You can see on my screen the initial thoughts, although I'm not a web designer and I'm not good at design apparently, on how this website should look like, but with the help of experts in website design and data management, Kypriot Character was created. The phrase Kypriot Character, Kypriot Character, is attested in Aeschylus Suppliants commenting on the unusual appearance of Danaus' daughters, which is remarkably different from that of the Argive women. The couplet has also long been recognized to contain a metaphor taken from the coinage, since the term character, character, is used in the numismatic terminology to describe the obverse die, but has also been adopted in the archaeological research as early as the late 19th century, initially to denote the aesthetic peculiarities of Cypriot sculpture. The use of this term, Kypriot character, was gradually expanded to embrace the composite cultural identity of the island. The logo design has also been thought of as we wanted to reflect this Cypriot originality. The synthesis of the website's logo is not a modern graphic originality. It has been thought, engraved, and represented on the Cypriot coinage, I'll show it again, by the successors of a veteran of Salamis, dated before the middle of the 5th century BC. They indeed transformed two separate symbols in one iconographic type. One figural symbol, the ankh, the Egyptian symbol of life, and one Cypriot syllabic script symbol, the pa, initial of the word king in the local script of the island, that both refer to the royal status and the exclusive authority of the kings to issue coins. So the website has been created using open access tools with a user-friendly and minimalistic design, respecting accessibility issues. One can visit the website from a computer, from an iPad, and from their phone. It proposes information about the project and the funding, a numismatic database that we will see in detail, an articles section with original papers, a bibliography database, and other sections that are useful, such as events and links of interest. There is also a multimedia section that it is proposed at the bottom of each page of the website, where lectures and educational videos on secret history, archaeology, and numismatics are proposed. The website has been created using Django, a Python web framework, free and open source, with full admin privileges in an interface that can be easily handled even by a numismatist as myself. While the website creation was ongoing, the database that would host the coin data was created in FileMaker, where specific fields with drop-down lists and interconnections were designed and adapted to the specific numismatic needs of the Cypriot coinage with the help of expert technicians. And an empty database is no use to no one, so in order to add coins into it, scientific missions were undertaken all around the world. As you can see on the screen, research expeditions for studying the Cypriot coins have been taking place in Greece, France, Cyprus, Denmark, when we were able to travel, Germany, the United Kingdom, Sweden, Russia, and Spain, and thousands of Cypriot coins have been added in the database between 2014 and 2015. But an important collection that included Cypriot coins remained, the collection of the American Numismatic Society in New York, where more than 400 Cypriot coins and circa 300 bronze and gold coins of the Cypriot kings required in situ study. The scientific mission to New York was realized in the framework of the Anabathmis project, and the addition of those coins to the database, as well as their upload on the website, has been performed this current year. So in the coins section of the website, one cannot see all the coins that have been added in the database because there are permission issues with many of those coins. They're available for study, but not for diffusion offline. And one can really search for a coin by using the search option with various choices, or they can choose to see coins from a specific coin collection, as is the case of the American Numismatic Society. By clicking on the coins option, one can see the coins from this collection. And by choosing one of those coins, one can enter the information in detail together with the link to the museum's online database. What is interesting to mention here is that the images that you see online are mirrored on the website after a special permission from the museums, which means that they are not on the website, making it really heavy. The mirroring of the images allows, of course, to avoid overloading the website, but also allows the return of the user trafficking to the museum's website, which is always important. Of course, any errors spotted in the images, for example, missing images or obverse and reverse images switched erroneously, should be corrected by the museum directly in order for them to appear correctly on the website. But nobody wants errors as long as they are spotted. So usually museums tend to correct any errors that are viewed through this project. The information regarding each coin is complete, containing data on the issuing authority, as you can see here, the mint, the king, the dating, on the provenance, the physical and typological descriptions, with detailed coin legends, including Greek, Phoenician, and Cypriot Slavic. You can see here on the example, the obverse description in Cypriot Slavic script, Evelthon, that is of the king Evelthon of Salamis. Each entry is accompanied by bibliographical references that you can see at the bottom of the page, as well, that are linked to the bibliography part of the website that we will discuss briefly in a few minutes. What is really interesting in all this effort which is actually my personal lifetime research project, is that the numismatic database uses stable numismatic identifiers and links open data methodologies established by the Numisma.org project. For example, mints, materials, and denominations are linked to the Numisma IDs ontologies. At the same time, my proper research on Cypriot coinages will contribute to the Numisma.org, as I will provide them with the names of the Cypriot rulers, which will also appear in their ontologies section. So collaborations is, in such endeavors, the most important keywords, I believe. So together with the numismatic aspect of the project, which is the main core of data on the website, I will briefly present two more sections of the website, which I believe will be of interest to many of you. The bibliography database includes all the studies related to Cypriot numismatics that have been published from 1836 to 2014, counting more than 600 entries. The entire bibliography has been compiled by Dr. Anne Struber-Yuriadis and has been updated and organized in such a way so that it is linked to the numismatic database and thus proposes to users papers or books in relation to specific coin types. The whole process of linking the bibliography and the coin data is something that it is proposed during the data entry and can be controlled by the coin and bibliography database in FileMaker, but also from the Django or website management tool. I'm managing both the website and the database, so for me it is really easy to update and upload the coin and the bibliography data to appear online with just the click of a button. Returning on the bibliography section of the website, the visitor can search by author, title, part of the title, year of publication, or even keywords. There's also the possibility for searches by filling a word or phrase. But what is really interesting here is that one can also search by content. For example, if I type the word Ankh, that Egyptian symbol of life that we've seen before in the logo, the bibliography provides me with titles that mention that word on their content, but not necessarily on their title. How did we manage to do that? Actually, what I have done was that I have provided for each one of the entries that were books and papers read and used in my own research, keywords that were attached to those entries. This allows the user a more thorough search and makes this tool, I believe, far more handy. But the bibliography is also something that is limited to numismatists, since, at least for now, it proposes only numismatic references, which is why the next section of the website, the article section, is an asset for a larger public, specialized or general. The section articles of the website proposes original scientific papers written especially for the Cypriot Character website by 50 external collaborators, each one of them an expert in their own specific field of research. They are original papers of 3,000 words published on the website for the first time. They are proposed in English and in Greek and pertain to the history, archaeology, and numismatics of ancient Cyprus from the geometric to the Roman period. And 10% of them, which I find really interesting, is written by researchers who just finished their PhD thesis, still unpublished, and propose a concise overview of their methodology and conclusions. The articles are accompanied by their references, illustrations, a selected bibliography, and a digital location map of the places mentioned in each paper. They are organized into the 9 following thematic sections: numismatics, archaeology, epigraphy, kingdoms and kings, Cyprus and the others, cult and religion, economy and trade, collection of Cypriot antiquities, and research projects regarding Cyprus or numismatics in general. The majority of the papers concern Cypriot archaeology, that's at 38% approximately, while numismatics are the second largest category. So far, 30 articles have been published and 33 articles are currently into translation and editing process and will be published online soon. Since its creation in 2015, the content of the website has been constantly updated by myself with the occasional help of students during their practice. Until now, Almost 64,000 users have visited the website, 13% of which has returned to visit it again. So they found something interesting in it, which is positive. The visitors come mainly from Cyprus and Greece, but also from all over the world. With the Anavathmis project, 400 coins were added on the coin database, which is a very important addition, but further funding would allow the addition of more coins, the addition of more articles, the update of the bibliography from 2014 to today, as well as important upgrade and maintenance issue, which is always the problem with in the digital world that we live in. So I would like to thank you for your attention. I'm always open to any comments or suggestions regarding the website. And thank you again for your time.
We thank Evangelini for her paper. And now we are going to the next project that has been developed by Elena Martin Gonzalez and Paschalis Paschidis. Dr. Elena Martin Gonzalez pursued classical studies at the University of Valladolid and obtained a doctoral degree in 2011. She is currently a postdoctoral researcher at the Institute of Historical Research of the National Hellenic Research Foundation, where she is responsible for the archive of Macedonian inscriptions of the Department of Greek and Roman Antiquity, with an appointment from the Agnes and Michael Sakellariou Foundation. Dr. Paschalis Paschidis is a research director in our institute, and his research focuses mainly on the ancient Greek epigraphy and the Hellenistic history. Today, they are going to speak about documentary corpora between past and present, the online supplements to the epigraphic corpora from Upper Macedonia and Veria. Please.
Thank you and good morning to everyone. I will share my screen, if you may. Thank you. Hi. Thank you again. We would like to start by thanking the organizers of the conference for the opportunity to present the result of our work within the frame of the Anavathmis project, the electronic supplements to the corpora of inscriptions from Upper Macedonia and Veroia. The choice of topic and format, as we will try to explain in what follows, is far from arbitrary. On the contrary, it meets an urgent demand to provide a second life to the epigraphic corpora that are still valuable, but do need revision and update in order to continue being so. The preparation of an epigraphic corpus, for those who don't know it, while observing the dictates of the discipline, is not an instantly gratifying job. It requires a lot of archival work in order to establish the precise number and the origin of inscriptions, unearthed in times when recording all relevant data in a museum inventory was hardly a given. It necessitates considerable work in libraries too, to record and analyze all editions and commentaries of every single inscription, in publications often beyond the thematic area of specialization of any single researcher. It relies upon time and money-consuming autopsies, and then upon painstaking taking and double-checking of documentary material, photographs and squeezes. It also requires a solid grasp of the history and historical geography of the area in question, and it also requires a team able to fully exploit as evidence and comment upon inscriptions from all three possible points of view, the one of the archaeologist, the one of the historian, and the one of the philologist. In fact, the history of Greek epigraphy is full of very illustrative cases as to the dangers and frustration faced by those researchers involved in the production of epigraphic corpora, starting by the very founder of the discipline, the great German philologist August Beck, in the early decades of the 19th century. Inspired by the encyclopedic zeal of the period and the conviction that the study of antiquity should include all sorts of evidence, Beck set as a goal of the Royal Academy of Sciences in Berlin to collect, study, comment upon, and publish all surviving Greek inscriptions from antiquity. He was the mastermind and key contributor of the Corpus Inscriptionum Graecarum, the first and last collection of all Greek inscriptions known at the time, arranged geographically. Beck's collection eventually laid the essential guidelines and the methodology for the production of epigraphic corpora, no matter how much these were refined and codified in the decades that followed. The downside to Beck's scholarly program, however, was that it was completely unrealistic already at the time of its inception, as he himself acknowledged in 1815, 10 years before the publication of the first volume of the Corpus, in a letter to the Prussian Minister of Education. There, you can see it on the screen, after complaining about the need to leave aside his main research and dedicate all his efforts for the following 4 years, he thought, to the compilation of the Greek inscriptions, he pessimistically concludes, "This work is too heavy a burden for me." With hundreds of inscribed monuments being discovered every year, especially in the late 19th and 20th centuries, it soon became evident that the publication of inscriptions could not be the task of a single research group. The successor to CID, Inscriptiones Graecae, was conceived on a different mode. Its geographical corpus would be the task of specific scholars, regardless of origin and institutional affiliation. However, the dramatic historical events of the first half of the 20th century led to the abandonment of the preparation for the corpora for several regions of the Greek world and to the very slow progress in other areas. Macedonia, our area of interest, is a case in point. In June 16, 1936, the young American epigraphist Charles Edson signed an agreement with the Berlin Academy for the publication of all Greek inscriptions from Macedonia, estimating that the whole project would be completed again within 4 years. His estimates proved, as Beck's, too optimistic. Despite his great efforts and his exemplary collection of the epigraphical material, Edson managed to complete only the volume with inscriptions of Thessaloniki 36 years later, in 1972. As he himself declares in 1953, in a letter to Klaffenbach, director of Inscriptiones Graecae at the time, "There is, I feel, no other kind of scholarly activity which so completely reduces one to a condition of abject humility as attempting to edit a corpus." The gap left by Edson has been partly covered by the Macedonian program of our institute, which placed the epigraphy of Macedonia at the epicenter of its research activity since its inception in 1979. The first part of ancient Macedonia to be covered was decided to be Upper Macedonia, the fourth Macedonian district in the ancient administrative division of the kingdom. And the result was the volume Epigraphes Anno Macedonias, published in 1985. The second area to be covered was Lower Macedonia, the third Macedonian district. The first volume of Epigraphes Cato Macedonias, covering the inscriptions of Beroia, was published in 1998. It was followed by a separate publication of the inscriptions from the Sanctuary of the Mother of the Gods at Lefkopetra, in the territory of ancient Beroia, published in 2000. In 2015, the second volume of Epigraphes Cato Macedonias, covering the rest of the third district, including the two royal capitals of Ege and Pella, was published. We are currently working on the two corpora of inscriptions from the second Macedonian district, the area between the Axios River and the Kerdilia Mountains, in a project funded by the Agni and Mikhail Sakellariou Foundation. The problem with epigraphic corpora, however, whether old or recent, and regardless of form or the medium of publication, print or digital, book or database, is that despite all the hard work that goes into their preparation, they become outdated almost already by the time they are published. New material is published every year. New readings for published inscriptions are proposed. Older ones are discarded. Vexing interpretive problems for some inscriptions are solved while others arise. And the volume of relevant literature rises exponentially. More importantly, The very existence of an epigraphic corpus facilitates first insight into the known material and offers the impetus for new studies. In a sense, the very success of a documentary corpus becomes the very cause of its own outdatedness. All this hardly means that it becomes completely obsolete. On the contrary, it represents a turning point in the study of a particular area and remains important over the years. Nevertheless, an update is needed for those who wish either to study and make use of an individual inscription or to better understand the epigraphy, history, and archaeology of the region. Since the study of the epigraphic sources of a given area relies on parallels, it is essential for the scholars dealing with the history, archaeology, language, religion, institutional life, onomastic, etc. of any given area to have at their disposal all the epigraphic evidence. Available databases and bibliographical tools, though an extremely useful research tool, in the end rely on traditional prepared corpora. As a consequence, the need for comprehensive and constant updates for the epigraphic production of any given area remains a research desideratum. When therefore the opportunity arose in the context of the project Anabathmis to provide new epigraphic tools for the research community, which would take advantage of the research infrastructure and the firm commitment of the Institute to the Epigraphy of Macedonia, it was deemed useful to provide supplements to the two oldest corpora, the one of Upper Macedonia and the one of Beroia, in the form of e-books, freely available in EPUB and PDF form. A further incentive for our decision and the main reason that these supplements are written in English was the language barrier for the non-specialists. Our corpora are written in Greek, and we bear no illusions as to the number of people who may profit from the commentary. Moreover, in an effort to render the information gleaned from the epigraphic material more widely accessible, we decided to include translation of all texts, even fragmentary ones. As we soon discovered, the translation of elaborate and poorly preserved texts, such as the important edict of Governor Lucius Memmius Rufus on the revenues for the Gymnasium of Beroia and its financial management, proved to be a particularly demanding challenge given the difficulty of the balance between accuracy and readability. The two supplements consist of two sections. The first contains entries for the inscriptions published in the two printed corpora, 221 from Upper Macedonia, 512 from Beria. Each entry provides new information concerning the monument, when such information exists, translation of the text, bibliography after the publication of the printed corpora, an additional apparatus criticus when necessary, and additional commentary to the one provided in the printed corpora, also when necessary. Whenever possible, we checked the readings of inscriptions on photographs and squeezes of our archive. As far as the old material is concerned, we proceeded to new autopsies only in the case of those inscriptions which were not available for study when the original corpus was published. The second section of both supplements contains full editions with description, text, apparatus, and commentary for inscriptions on stone published after the publication of the corpora, 56 in the supplement to Upper Macedonia and 27 in the supplement to Beroia. Whenever possible, the inscribed monuments of this section were studied through autopsy, photographs, and squeezes. For reasons of consistency with the other corpora published by our institution, new inscriptions on material other than stone, painted inscriptions, and inscriptions on mosaics were not included in the main catalog, but were listed in an appendix. The relevant lists number 76 entries in the supplement to Upper Macedonia and 20 in the supplement to Beroia. A brief catalog of unpublished inscriptions known to us are included in both supplements. Finally, two separate indexes accompany the supplements, the first containing additions and corrections to the printed corpora, the second containing the new material, including the inscriptions of the appendixes. We'll see some examples now. The significance of the juxtaposition of old and new material, in other words, the benefit of comprehensiveness, becomes clear in a number of cases. The addition of the new epigraphic material from Beroia has allowed, for instance, a clearer understanding of the funerary monuments for gladiators from the city, a significant ensemble which testifies to the importance of the gladiatorial games held in the metropolis of Roman Macedonia. The danger of outdatedness outlined above is well illustrated here. The original corpus contained 21 such monuments, but shortly after its publication, a group of 6 new examples were published in 2000. And in 2006, the publication of the funerary epigram of the Venator Tilorobos that you can see on the screen added the last known published specimen. As the inscription informs us, Tilorobos returned to die in his homeland Beroia, badly wounded, presumably during one of his performances. The new material often highlights the constraints of the old. A group of dedicatory inscriptions from the temple of Apollo Mesoriscos in Elimia, which cover a time span of 4 centuries, offers us a rare glimpse of cultic continuity in an area, Upper Macedonia, for which the epigraphic evidence regarding sanctuaries is scarce and usually isolated and without context. Of particular interest in the case of Upper Macedonia is also the fact that the new material, both on stone and other surfaces, contains some of the oldest inscriptions in the area, such as the epitaph of Attia, you can see, dating back to the 5th century BC. New material often solves interpretive problems of the old one and then creates new problems. In the funerary inscription of Mahatas, son of Lykiros, from Pentavriso in Upper Macedonia, the deceased bears a characteristic Macedonian name, now attested in the area as far back as the end of the 6th century BC, inscribed in a calyx. The name of his father, Lykiros, was already attested in Beroia in the list of officers included in the letter of King Antigonos Doson. In the original corpus, it was explained as an engraver's mistake for Ekiros. The new inscription has confirmed the correct reading and interpretation, and thus solved the problem, but created a new one, since the etymology of the name Lykiros remains unclear. This dialogue between old and new is also highlighted by material from other areas of Macedonia. When the corpus of Upper Macedonia was published in 1985, sacred manumission acts, documents by which slave was dedicated to a deity and thus released from slavery, such as the description that you're seeing on the screen, AM 59, were very few. Today, after the publication of several dozens of such documents from all over Macedonia, we understand this category of inscriptions much better. In the ample relevant bibliography, AM 59 was rarely exploited. It so happens, however, that it contains a crucial parameter for the understanding of sacred manumission, namely that slave could be described both as free and as belonging to the temple of the deity to which he was consecrated. It is only now, after the review of the rest of the material, that an old piece of the puzzle finds its rightful place. We need to stress firmly that these supplements are meant to be used as supplements to, and not as a replacement of the 2 original corpora. Our decision not to reproduce the text of inscriptions or include information already set out in the original corpora was deliberate. These supplements are not new corpora, they are a research tool to be used alongside the 2 corpora. A research tool, moreover, that we hope to be able to renew at regular intervals. The rationale behind such an endeavor lies in the attempt to combine 2 desiderata, which need to be addressed simultaneously in all corpora or documentary sources. On the one hand, the long-established dictate of comprehensiveness, which teams dedicated to the epigraphy of a region are best equipped to serve, and which requires constant updating. On the other hand, the crucial need for feasibility, as far as human, financial, and time resources are concerned, a need which we would like to think that Beck himself and Edsel too would wholeheartedly acknowledge. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hélène and Paschalis, for your paper. And now I remind all participants to pose any question or any comment to our speakers. The last fourth speaker is Zisis Melissakis, who is a senior researcher in the section of Byzantine research of our institute. And he's an expert on Greek paleography and codicology. He works on monastic archives, especially in Mount Athos, and on Greek printed books from 15th to 19th centuries from Greek libraries. Today, he's going to speak about providing primary historical sources to the research community through the Anevathmis project, the database texts of post-Byzantine documents from Mount Athos. Zisis.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Καλημέρα σας. Ανοίξω λίγο το. Το 1985, το τότε Κέντρο Βυζαντινών Ερευνών, με τη δημοσίευση του πρώτου τόμου της εκδοτικής σειράς Οθωνικά Σύμμικτα, εγκαινίασε την επιστημονική καταγραφή των μεταβυζαντινών αθωνικών ελληνικών αρχαιακών συλλογών κατά μονή. Αν και το ενδιαφέρον του Κέντρου για τα αθωνικά αρχεία χρονολογείται από το 1962, όταν ξεκίνησαν οι αποστολές των μελών του σε αυτά, η έκδοση της σειράς, η οποία σήμερα έχει καλύψει 9 συλλογές, ήταν αυτή που προσέφερε το μεταβυζαντινό ανάλογο των πολύ παλαιότερων γαλλικών αρχίβ ντελατός, που εκδίδουν αποκλειστικά τα βυζαντινά έγγραφα του Αγίου Όρους. Η μεγάλη αξία του υλικού που προσφέρουν στο ερευνητικό κοινό τα αθωνικά σύμμικτα είναι προφανής. Ένας αριθμός εγγράφων που κατά μονή κυμαίνεται από αρκετές δεκάδες μέχρι αρκετές εκατοντάδες, χρονολογουμένων από τον 15ο αιώνα μέχρι το 1800 περίπου, ανάλογα με τη μονή μπορεί να ξεπερνούν αυτό το όριο κατά μερικά έτη, αν συντρέχουν ειδικοί ιστορικοί λόγοι, και με θεματολογία που άπτεται είτε εσωτερικών αγιορητικών υποθέσεων, εσωτερικά ζητήματα των μονών, σχέσεις αυτών μεταξύ τους, κεντρική διοίκηση της κοινότητας, είτε εξωτερικών, σχέσεις του όρους με το Πατριαρχείο Κωνσταντινούπολεως και με κοσμικές αρχές, σχέσεις των μονών με τα μετόχια τους, αλλά και με ιδιώτες σε διάφορα μέρη, είναι φανερό ότι αποτελεί θησαυρό πρωτογενούς τεκμηρίωσης, όχι μόνο για την ιστορία του Άθωνα, αλλά και πέρα από αυτόν του ελληνικού χώρου, της Βαλκανικής και ευρύτερα της Καθημάς Ανατολής. Η μεθοδολογία της καταγραφής που εφαρμόστηκε και συνεχίζει να εφαρμόζεται στους τόμους που προετοιμάζονται είναι αρκετά απλή και περιλαμβάνει τα εξής στοιχεία. Γενικό τίτλο κάθε εγγράφου και χρονολογία του, λεπτομερή φυσική περιγραφή του, αναλυτική επιτομή του περιεχομένου του, η οποία ακολουθεί πολύ στενά το κείμενο αυτού, αρχή του κειμένου, το incipit, και σχετική βιβλιογραφία. Το 2004, το περιεχόμενο των έως τότε δημοσιευμένων καταγραφών, καθώς και μερικών άλλων, συνολικά 5.000 περίπου, αποφασίστηκε να ενταχθεί σε βάση δεδομένων στο πλαίσιο του έργου Πανδέκτης, ακολουθώντας την παραπάνω διάρθρωση των μεταδεδομένων. Επρόκειτο δηλαδή στην πραγματικότητα για ψηφιοποίηση των μεταγραφών, στις οποίες προσθέθηκε αγγλική μετάφραση του κάθε τίτλου, μία ή περισσότερες πολύ μικρών διαστάσεων φωτογραφίες, thumbnails, για κάθε έγγραφο και λέξεις κλειδιά. Για τις τεχνολογικές δυνατότητες της εποχής, το έργο ήταν υψηλού επίπεδου. Και αν και έκτοτε δυστυχώς δεν εξυγχρονίστηκε, η χρησιμότητά του ήταν και παραμένει μεγάλη, αν μάλιστα ληφθεί υπόψη το καταγεγραμμένο ενδιαφέρον των χρηστών του. Ωστόσο, στα σχόλιά τους που δεχόμαστε όλα αυτά τα χρόνια, παρατηρούμε πάντα να επισημαίνεται η βασική έλλειψη που και εμείς γνωρίζουμε ότι υπάρχει τόσο στη βάση όσο και στις έντυπες καταγραφές του υλικού. Τα ίδια τα κείμενα των εγγράφων. Έλλειψη διότι ο ερευνητής της ιστορίας ικανοποιείται μεν όταν του παρέχονται πληροφορίες άμεσα προερχόμενες από πρωτογενείς πηγές, αλλά νιώθει ανασφαλής αν δεν του παρέχεται και η ίδια η πηγή, είτε σε φωτογραφία είτε σε πιστή απόδοσή της. Στην περίπτωση γραπτών πηγών, η μεταγραφή τους. Ώστε να έχει ο ίδιος τη δυνατότητα να την ελέγξει και να την αξιοποιήσει πλήρως, μόνος του, χωρίς το πιθανότατο φιλτράρισμά της από τον καταγραφέα ή τον τεκμηριωτή, όσο και αν αυτοί διαθέτουν την απαραίτητη εξειδίκευση και πείρα. Αυτή ακριβώς η ανάγκη αποτέλεσε την ιδέα για την παρούσα βάση μας στην αναβαθμίδα. Σε αντίθεση με τα πλήρως εκδεδομένα βυζαντινά έγγραφα του Αγίου Όρους των Αρχίβ Ντερατός, τα μεταβυζαντινά των εικών Σιμίκτων και του Πανδέκτη δεν συνοδεύονται από μεταγραφή τους για λόγους τόσο πρακτικούς, μεγάλος ο αριθμός τους, όσο και παλαιότητάς τους. Αν και η άποψη ότι το νεότερο αρχαιακό υλικό δεν αξίζει να μεταγράφεται και μάλιστα διπλωματικά έχει πλέον εγκαταληφθεί, τουλάχιστον όταν μιλάμε για τους δύο πρώτους αιώνες της Οθωμανικής κατάκτησης, για τους δύο επόμενους, 17ο και 18ο, συχνά επικρατεί ακόμη επιφυλακτικότητα. Συνεπώς, το περιεχόμενο της βάσης μας αποτελείται από αυτούσια κείμενα εγγράφων, κατά κανόνα εκτενή. Αν και το αρχικό σχέδιο προέβλεπε την εισαγωγή όλων των μεταβυζαντινών εγγράφων της Μονής Εσφυγμένου και μόνο, 109 έγγραφα, τελικώς το υλικό υπερδιπλασιάστηκε αριθμητικά, 232 έγγραφα, προσθέτοντας και το σύνολο των αντίστοιχων εγγράφων της Μονής Σταύρο Νικήτα, καθώς και μερικών επιλεγμένων από τις Μονές Παντοκράτορος, Ξηροποτάμου και Καρακάλου, με την πρόθεση σταδιακά να καταχωρηθούν και εκείνα όλων των υπολείπων αθωνικών ιδρυμάτων, με μόνη προϋπόθεση να έχει προηγηθεί η καταγραφή τους στα αθωνικά σύμμικτα, σύμφωνα πάντα με τις βασικές αρχές που περιγράψαμε πριν. Ο λόγος ύπαρξης αυτού του περιορισμού είναι ότι πίσω από τη δημοσίευση της φυσικής περιγραφής και των επιτομών, υπάρχει μια εξαντλητική επεξεργασία των εγγράφων, η οποία οφείλει να ολοκληρώνεται και να παρουσιάζεται στην ερευνητική κοινότητα πριν από την παρουσίαση των ίδιων των κειμένων τους, ώστε οι χρήστες της βάσης να έχουν μια πλήρη εικόνα κάθε συλλογής για να μπορούν να επιλέγουν τα έγγραφα των οποίων θα τους ενδιέφερε να μελετήσουν το κείμενο. Ωστόσο, όπως είδαμε, εκτός από τις δύο προαναφερθήσεις μονές, έχουν ήδη εκδοθεί οι περιγραφές και οι επιτομές των εγγράφων και άλλων. Και έτσι θα αρχίσουν να προστίθενται στη νέα βάση οι μεταγραφές και αυτών. Έως εδώ περιγράψαμε τη σχέση αλληλοσυμπλήρωσης που υπάρχει ανάμεσα στη νέα βάση της αναβαθμίδας και στους τόμους των αθωνικών συμμίκτων. Περισσότερο όμως μας προβλημάτισε η σχέση της με την παλαιότερη βάση του Πανδέκτη. Σε αυτή περιλαμβάνονται όλες οι πληροφορίες που παρέχουν και οι έντυπες καταγραφές μας, αλλά λόγω παλαιότητας του λογισμικού του Πανδέκτη, παρατηρούνται προβλήματα στην εμφάνιση ορισμένων εξ αυτών. Επίσης, το υλικό του Πανδέκτη έχει σταματήσει να εμπλουτίζεται, με αποτέλεσμα να απουσιάζει εντελώς εκείνο της Μονής Εσφυγμένου αλλά και της Μονής Αγίου Παύλου, το οποίο εκδόθηκε στα αθωνικά σύμμικτα λίγα χρόνια μετά την ολοκλήρωση της παλαιάς αυτής βάσης, ενώ απίθανος θεωρείται ένας μελλοντικός εμπλουτισμός της. Από την άλλη, ήταν εξ αρχής σαφές ότι οι μεταγραφές στη βάση μας της αναβαθμίδας οφείλουν να συνοδεύονται από ένα μίνιμουμ αριθμό πληροφοριών για τα αντίστοιχα έγγραφα, ώστε να επιτυγχάνεται η αναγνώρισή τους. Για τους λόγους αυτούς, αποφασίσαμε η αναγνώριση να γίνεται μέσα από τη σύνδεση των μεταγραφών με τις αντίστοιχες επιτομές των αθωνικών συμμίκτων. Προσθέσαμε λοιπόν στη βάση μας το όνομα της μονής, στην οποία φυλάσσεται κάθε έγγραφο, τη χρονολογία του, τον ταξινομικό αριθμό του, τον αύξοντα αριθμό και τον τίτλο που φέρει στην έκδοση της επιτομής του και παραπομπή στις σχετικές σελίδες των αθωνικών συμμίκτων. Με τον τρόπο αυτό, ο χρήστης της βάσης μπορεί να φτάσει στη μεταγραφή που τον ενδιαφέρει, γνωρίζοντας τα βασικά στοιχεία ταυτότητας του εγγράφου από την έντυπη καταγραφή του, αλλά και το αντίστροφο. Επειδή όμως επιθυμούμε μια πληρέστερη παρουσίαση της ταυτότητας κάθε εγγράφου στη βάση, προσπαθούμε να εκμεταλλευτούμε και ορισμένα τουλάχιστον από τα δεδομένα του Πανδέκτη, εκείνα που αφορούν στη φυσική περιγραφή του, τα οποία το Εθνικό Κέντρο Τεκμηρίωσης μας παρέδωσε, ώστε με τη βοήθεια των τεχνικών της αναβαθμίδας να τα εντάξουμε μαζικά στη νέα βάση και να τα αντιστοιχίσουμε σε ήδη υπάρχουσες μεταγραφές, αλλά και σε όσες από εκείνες που θα προστίθενται μελλοντικά είναι δυνατόν. Όσο για τα δεδομένα των φυσικών περιγραφών, από μονές που δεν υπάρχουν και δεν θα προσθεθούν ποτέ στον Πανδέκτη, αυτά θα καταχωρηθούν προσεχώς με το χέρι από τους τόμους, προερχόμενα από τους τόμους των αθωνικών συμμίκτων. Από τα παραπάνω γίνεται φανερό ότι στόχος μας δεν είναι η αντικατάσταση της παλαιάς βάσης του Πανδέκτη με μια νεότερη και πληρέστερη, αλλά η συμπλήρωσή του υπάρχοντος περιεχομένου της. Ας έρθουμε τώρα στην κύρια οντότητα της νέας βάσης μας, δηλαδή στις μεταγραφές των εγγράφων. Όποιος έχει επιχειρήσει να μεταγράψει κείμενο από οποιοδήποτε χειρόγραφο και ιδίως έγγραφο, γνωρίζει τις πολλές δυσκολίες που ενέχει αυτή η εργασία. Η διπλωματική μέθοδος μεταγραφής απαιτεί την απόδοση κάθε λεπτομέρειας του χειρογράφου, αλλαγές στίχων, ανάπτυξη συντομογραφιών, τήρηση της ορθογραφίας του πρωτοτύπου, δήλωση χασμάτων ή αβέβαιων αναγνώσεων, λόγω φθορών, διαγραφών, προστικών κτλ., με τα καθιερωμένα πάντα σύμβολα. Αν και ένας απλούστερος τρόπος μεταγραφής θα μας απάλασε από πολλά τεχνικά ζητήματα, επιλέξαμε να υιοθετήσουμε τον διπλωματικό, ως πλέον αποδεκτό επιστημονικά για κείμενα πρωτογενών πηγών. Ένα μεγάλο μέρος των μεταγραφών είχε ήδη πραγματοποιηθεί από εκδότες των Αθωνικών Συμμίκτων, προκειμένου για τις μονές Σφιγμένου και Σταυρονικήτα, για διευκόλυνση της εργασίας τους, ενώ κάποιες άλλες είχαν περιληφθεί σε παλαιότερα μεμονωμένα δημοσιεύματα. Όλες αυτές εντάχθηκαν στη βάση, αφού πρώτα ελέγχθηκαν με αντιπαραβολή από φωτογραφίες των αντίστοιχων εγγράφων που φυλάσσονται στο Ινστιτούτο Ιστορικών Ερευνών και σε πολλές περιπτώσεις προσαρμόστηκαν στις προδιαγραφές διπλωματικής μεταγραφής που εφαρμόσαν. Τα υπόλοιπα έγγραφα μεταγράφηκαν εξ αρχής, επίσης από τις φωτογραφίες μας. Όλη αυτή την εργασία ελέγχου νέων μεταγραφών και καταχώρησης έφερε εις πέρας ο εξωτερικός μας συνεργάτης στην αναβαθμίδα, διδάκτορας Νίκος Μελβάνη, ενώ στη βάση υπάρχει χωριστό πεδίο, στο οποίο δηλώνεται το πρόσωπο που διενήργησε την μεταγραφή. Κατά την καταχώρηση των μεταγραφών στη βάση δεδομένων, βρεθήκαμε αντιμέτωποι με προβλήματα που συνδέονται με τη μορφή του κειμένου τους. Σε αυτό, όπως είδαμε, προσθέθηκε ένας μεγάλος αριθμός ειδικών συμβόλων, παρενθέσεις, αγγείλες, κάθετες και πλάγιες γραμμές, διάσπαρτον αδιακρίτως στις άκρες και στο εσωτερικό πολλών λέξεων, όπως επιτάσσει η διπλωματική μεταγραφή. Επίσης, σε κάθε σημείο αλλαγής τοίχου προσθέσαμε αύξοντα αριθμό του, στη χαρίθμιση δηλαδή, όπως έχει καθιερωθεί στις εκδόσεις κειμένου. Ωστόσο, όλες αυτές οι συνεχείς διαταράξεις της ροής του κειμένου συνεπάγονται αδυναμία σύλληψής του ως ενιαίου από τον υπολογιστή, κυρίως όταν επιχειρείται αναζήτηση συγκεκριμένων λέξεων σε αυτό. Το πρόβλημα επιδεινώνεται από τα πολλά ορθογραφικά σφάλματα που συναντούμε συχνά στα έγγραφα αυτής της εποχής, τα οποία μεταφέρονται αυτούσια στη μεταγραφή τους. Υπενθυμίζω άλλωστε ότι η μεταγραφή γίνεται φυσικά σε πολυτονικό σύστημα, και όλα αυτά δυσκολεύουν επίσης την αναζήτηση. Η λύση δεν είναι άγνωστη και βρίσκεται στη μετατροπή των απλών κειμένων σε κείμενα HTML, το Hypertext Markup Language, δηλαδή με χρήση της γλώσσας σήμανσης υπερκειμένου, όπως λέγουμε στα ελληνικά, με την οποία θα λέγαμε ότι ένα απλό κείμενο δομείται κατά τρόπο που να γίνεται κατανοητό στον υπολογιστή, σύμφωνα πάντα με αρχές που έχουμε ορίσει. Για παράδειγμα, λέξεις που διαιρούνται σε δύο διαδοχικούς στίχους που συλλαβίζονται με το σύμβολο αλλαγής στίχου και τον αύξοντα αριθμό αυτού να μεσολαβεί, μπορούν να εκλειφθούν ως ενιαίες. Ομοίως, παρενθέσεις ή αγγείλες που παρεμβάλλονται στο εσωτερικό λέξεων για δήλωση συντομογραφίας ή χάσματος μπορούν να διαβαστούν σαν να μην υπήρχαν τα σύμβολα αυτά. Η πλατφόρμα Heurist προσφέρει δυνατότητα τέτοιας μετατροπής του κειμένου, την οποία όμως δεν εκμεταλλευτήκαμε έως τώρα, ελλείψη και ειδικότερων τεχνικών γνώσεων από μέρους μας. Ακόμη περισσότερα θα μπορούσαμε να επιτευχθούμε τη χρήση του γνωστού προτύπου TEI, το Text Encoding Initiative, το οποίο ειδικεύεται στην κωδικοποίηση ψηφιακών κειμένων των ανθρωπιστικών επιστημών και μάλιστα πρωτογενών πηγών. Με τέτοιο τρόπο, ώστε να είναι αναγνώσιμα από υπολογιστές. Με την εφαρμογή του στην παρούσα βάση δεδομένων, θα ήταν δυνατόν λόγου χάρη να ορίσουμε την ιδιότητα συγκεκριμένων λέξεων σε κάθε κείμενο, πιο ορθά να τις περιγράψουν, όπως ονόματα προσώπων ή αντικειμένων, επιτυγχάνοντας μια συνολικά πιο έξυπνη βάση, η οποία θα μπορούσε να διασυνδεθεί πλήρως με άλλες αναλόγου περιεχομένου. Και στην περίπτωση αυτή, όμως, δεν στάθηκε δυνατόν να εκμεταλλευτούμε αυτές τις εξελιγμένες δυνατότητες, αν και το Heurist προβλέπει μια ενσωμάτωση του TEI 5 σε έκδοση 5, κάτι που ασφαλώς θα επιχειρηθεί μελλοντικά. Με τις παρατηρήσεις αυτές, φτάνουμε στις σχεδιαζόμενες επεκτάσεις της βάσης δεδομένων μας. Όπως έγινε κατανοητό, πρόκειται για μια πολύ απλή στο σχεδιασμό της βάσης, της οποίας ο όγκος βρίσκεται κυρίως σε μία οντότητα, σε ένα πεδίο από τα λίγα πεδία που υπάρχει, αυτό που με εκτενή κείμενα. Ως εκ τούτου, η καινοτομία της δεν έγκυται τόσο σε δόμηση πληροφοριών, αλλά στην παροχή για πρώτη φορά στους χρήστες ατόφιων των συγκεκριμένων πρωτογενών πηγών από τον Άθωνα. Πέρα από τη συνεχή προσθήκη νέου υλικού από άλλες αγιορτικές μονές, η σκέψη μας πηγαίνει σε ανάλυση και δόμηση των πληροφοριών που προκύπτουν από τα κείμενα των εγγράφων. Έως τώρα, το μόνο εργαλείο για αυτή την ανάλυση ήταν η παλαιότερη περιορισμένη δυνατοτήτων των βάση του Πανδέκτη. Είδαμε ότι είχε, δούλευε με τη λογική των λέξεων κλειδιών. Και τα ευρετήρια, βέβαια, των σχετικών τόμων των Αθωνικών Συμμίκτων, αφού οι έντυπες επιτομές και οι περιγραφές των εγγράφων προσφέρονται μόνο για γραμμική ανάγνωση κάθε περίπτωση, κάθε εγγράφου χωριστά. Αντιθέτως, προχωρώντας σε αποδελτίωση των εγγράφων στο πλαίσιο βάσης δεδομένων, θα καταλήξουμε σε μια νέα ταξινόμηση των πληροφοριών, από την οποία ασφαλώς θα προκύψει πολύτιμη τροφή για ιστορικές έρευνες. Για παράδειγμα, θα ήταν δυνατόν να δημιουργηθούν οντότητες με τα πρόσωπα, τις ενέργειές τους, τα ιδρύματα, τις περιοχές που αναφέρονται στα έγγραφα και να δομηθούν ανάλογα με τα δεδομένα. Σε δεύτερο επίπεδο, η βάση μπορεί να επεκταθεί με άλλα είδη γραπτών πρωτογενών πηγών από το Άγιον Όρος, όπως λόγου χάρη τα ιστορικού περιεχομένου σημειώματα που βρίσκουμε σε χειρόγραφους κώδικες. Τέτοια βάση ήδη έχουμε ξεκινήσει να υλοποιούμε για τη συλλογή χειρογράφων όμως της Μονής Πάτων. Σε αυτά η ιστορική πληροφορία, σε αυτά τα σημειώματα, η ιστορική πληροφορία είναι σαφώς πιο λιτή και περιορισμένη σε σχέση με εκείνη που προσφέρουν τα έγγραφα. Αλλά δεν πάβει να είναι άμεση και πολύτιμη, ιδίως για ζητήματα καθημερινού βίου που δεν καλύπτονται συνήθως από τα έγγραφα. Με τον τρόπο αυτό, αναγόμαστε σε μια μεγάλη συγκέντρωση επεξεργασμένων και συνδεδεμένων μεταξύ τους πηγών από τον Άθωνα, για τον Άθωνα, αλλά και πολύ πέρα από αυτόν. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Thank you very much, Zisis. The four papers are finished, so we have time for questions or comments. I don't see any question, written question or comment. Oh, yes. One of our attendees asks, what about paradata? Are you taking into account the registration of paradata? I don't know if the questions concern only Zisis Melissakis or all of speakers, of our speakers. Is anyone who knows to answer or wants to answer?
May I ask something? The paradata concerns the last presentation of Zisis Melissakis so generally. I think the question was put on 11/13, so perhaps it refers to data that accompany the manuscripts that were presented by Melissakis, by our colleague Zisis. But he has to clarify anyway.
Yes, well, maybe it's a technical question.
Maybe could explain what is the meaning of paradata. Paradata. I know metadata, but paradata. What is the meaning of?
Is an anonymous attendee. If
is the data about?
Yes, there is a comment. Paradata is the data about the decision making during the production of data.
Mm-hmm. The decision making. Maybe it's not only for me this question.
So
it's for all of you. It's a question for all the speakers.
No one.
That's an example could clarify the question.
Yes. We expect. We are waiting. So, is there anyone who wants to speak or to make a comment?
Okay.
There is a comment here from Marina Tumburi concerning paradata. For example, why choose distance X from an object during digitization?
So that concerns only photographs, maybe. Digital photos.
No. All categories of data. Response is a new field.
But it concerns, excuse me if I may speak, this is a question that concerns the methodology and the approach to the subject we study in our research. So the paradata comes from the digitizations of our data, but in any way, it's a question of methodology, and methodology, of course, it's something that accompanies all the questions we have about our materials, the way we treat the material, the way we present the material. It's a very general question, I think.
Okay, I think to move on. Any question, comment? No? So, if there is no question, we can conclude, and we will be back. Now we can make a break, and we'll be back at 12 o'clock for the next and fourth session. Thank you all.